David toward a temple, and David is right, my grandfather's right, and even though everyone else can't see it, when you really take hold of that, living for God can be easy.
Satan.
It's us. We cannot give out the hope to win. We cannot get out of our own way. And it goes back to what Brother Dave brought up just a moment ago, that we, it's us, can get carried away in our own lusts, in our own ego, in our own ideas or whatever it may be. We cannot get out of the way, we mess everything up. But when we understand that we're in Christ, that we're out of our own way, so to speak, we understand the fullness of what it was. To be honest, you can't fully understand, and you cannot grasp the depths of faith short of Christ. But when you begin to understand what He's done for us, and we're able to get out of our own way, then truly living for God is easy.
Yeah, the grandfather, I'm studying the Word. Sometimes we'll refer to it as we swirl things up. We have a way to swirl
it up. We swirl it up.
That's what we do. Like you said, he worded it right. We get it our own way. You guys made mention. It reminds me of the comedian Flip Wilson who used to say, "The devil made me do it."
Oh, yeah.
And it's not the devil that made us do it. It's our own flesh. It's our own desire. It's our own.
I'll tell you a story real quick about my dad. It's a kind of an old story. My grandmother used to tell it. Dad used to tell it too. It's probably been 20 years since they've said it. When my dad was a kid, my grandmother dressed him up. His son did best to go to church. And one Sunday, he just saw a mud puddle and decided he wanted to go get a mud puddle. So my grandmother got mad at him and said, "Donnie, what were you doing? Why did you do that?" He said, "The devil made me do it." But in all honesty, he did it himself because he wanted to. But that's the key. Before we take a break, that's something else. There are some of us that allow that temptation to take root because we want it to. It's not a matter of trying to fight it. We want it to. We want it. And that's a very dangerous
place. That's where the devil plays in. He takes that temptation, yeah, that lust that's in us, and then he plays it.
Oh, he exasperates it to the nth degree. But the fact is, I think a lot of times, there are certain people, not saying in all cases, but and many times with all of, we want that. It comes up. We like it. Right. We want it. We want that dopamine rush, whatever it may be. We want to feel that high. We want to feel that whatever it may be, conquering, or whatever it is. When it's all said and done, all you've done is just made a mess of yourself. Now I feel like this is a very important aspect of this whole discussion, and probably the most important aspect of this discussion. Temptation will come, but we don't have to let it take root. Why? Because we have the shield of faith. Faith in Christ, who He is and what He's done. We'll come right back after the break, and we're going to pick up and continue on.
One of the most unique daily devotions you'll find anywhere is the Expositor's Word for every day. You'll get a message for every day of the year. All messages have a focus on the cross of Christ. Messages that deal with modern day problems. How to apply the Word of God in the Expositor's Word for every day daily devotional. You'll get a wealth of doctrine to help strengthen and encourage your daily walk with the Lord.
Sinfulness. not to bring condemnation, but truly when we understand that, when we really have a revelation of just really how messed up we are. As you said, Brother Swaggart always says, we're swirled up. Boy, are we swirled up. When you have a revelation of that, then it really puts you in a position now to really begin to walk in a revelation of the cross and of the solution. So, point being this, is most Christians, we cover ourselves with fig leaves. We make like our sin, our situation, our sinfulness is not as bad as it really is, but it's bad.
It's bad.
I mean, Jesus said, out of the heart of man proceeds all sorts of wickedness.
Murders, envy, adulteries, fornication.
When I was a young Christian, I'd look at failure and I would look at sin, kind of with a self-righteous, judgmental mentality. And I would never do that as a Christian. How could they do that? But now I've gotten to the place because God has revealed to me how deeply depraved I am. When I see failure, I see me.
Yeah.
When I see adultery, when I see fornication, when I see envy, strife, jealousy, any sin that there is in the book, when I see that, and I see someone fail in that, I see me.
I think that's a good thought and a good idea, simply because I think most people don't understand that if it were not for the grace of God operating in their life, they would be doing the same thing.
Exactly.
Christian or non-Christian.
There you go. Right.
And I feel like when we have this mentality where, you know, they look down on people for their failure. Number one, that's a wrong attitude to have at all costs. We are never, as Christians, we are never to look down on our fellow Christians for failure. We are never to gossip about them. We're never to look them while they're down. In fact, we see that all throughout really history is that Christians have devoured one another on the reality of failure. We've kicked each other while we're down because people have made mistakes, but we can't use them anymore. They've made a mess of things. We got to discard them, and it's over with. It's done. And yet, what does the Lord say about it? We're going to restore each other.
Right, right.
When we
do our spirit.
Yeah, because that's the key. Most of them are operating in a very selfish, judgmental, as you said, manner.
Right.
And I feel if that's the case, nobody can survive that.
Self-righteousness, man. If you judge someone, when you point the finger at someone with a final judgment and a mentality that, well, I would never do something like that, you don't understand the depth of your own depression. You don't understand that we're all in the same boat, man.
Right.
There ain't no one better than another. We are all messed up. You get that revelation, and then you won't be too quick to point the finger at someone and be judgmental toward them. You'll want to restore them.
You want to restore them. And you know, I heard somebody say something very similar years ago, and I'm trying to remember who said it, and I don't recall who said it. But they made the statement that they said, when you see somebody that is in fault, that is experiencing a failure, instead of kicking them while they're down, this is an opportunity for us to realize that we would be in the same boat if it were not for the mercy. And when we realize that, and we understand that, and say, you know what? Number one, we're family. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. We serve one God, one Father, one Spirit, one Lord, one faith, as Paul would lay out in Ephesians. And if we understand that, and we see someone that's been caught in a failure, instead of looking down on them, this is the chance for us to say, how can we help?
Right.
Because understanding we would be in the same boat is another thing. You remember the old golden rule? Treat people how you want to be treated? You wouldn't want the whole world coming down on you when you make your mistake. And if you don't want the whole world coming down on you when you fail, that's an opportunity for us. Once when we see others, treat people how we would want to be treated. Let's instead of dogging them, instead of jumping on them, instead of knocking them down and kicking them while they're down, telling them they're useless now, you made a mistake, you're old, and God never says that again.
Right.
Thankful. And we've got, I said this in church one time, and you can feel like this hush in the room. And I said, you better be glad that God doesn't do to you what you do to others. You better be thankful that God doesn't castigate you and kick you while you're down and tell you you've blown it. It's over for you. You might as well go and do something. Go sell insurance for the rest of your life. I don't want you in my presence. I don't want you in my fellowship. I don't want you in my kingdom. You better be glad God doesn't take that attitude with us. And if that's the case, we realize that God won't do that with us. We must not do that to our brothers and sisters in Christ.
That's why, you know, Paul in Galatians chapter 6, and he said, you who are spiritual,
yes,
you are such a one who has overtaken the fall. And he said this, he said, do it in the spirit of meekness, yes, lest you also be tempted. So with the mindset of recognizing that, again, as you said, except for the grace of God, I would be there too. I'm no better than you.
I'm no better than anybody else. But here's another thing Jesus said for us regarding the Beatitudes, blessed are the meek. Blessed are those who treat people with kindness, who restore people, who will work with people, who will help those, who will practice forgiveness. That we have to, I think that the church has lost sight of these things. And we're very good at building people up, only to watch them and only to tear them down. And whenever we tear them down, we don't like to build them back up again. We discard them and say, you're done. But God never does that with anyone. Not only does He build us up, but when we are taken with a fault and we make a mistake, God is always there to build us back up as long as we don't quit believing. If we continue to pursue the faith and pursue cross of Christ, pursue Calvary, pursue Christ Himself, He's always going to be there to restore us.
Aren't you glad that God is about restoration?
Yes.
And about restoration. Where would we be in life? I hope that in my ministry that I endeavor to be someone of restoration, someone of redemption, because that's where we all are. We may not have been taken by a fault that's public, but we've all needed the grace of God. We were all in sin, and we've all fallen short of the glory of God. So this high and mighty, holier-than-thou attitude that some people have, that just is like, man, you know that if it weren't for the grace of God, where would you be? So hopefully we're about redemptive leadership in the church, restorative leadership. You know, obviously sin is very serious. We take it very seriously. It costs Jesus had to go to Calvary because of it. I mean, it's very, very serious. But thankfully, the Lord is a God of restoration.
Yeah.
And when we get off the mark, we can come back.
Let me say this. I've been thinking about this a lot lately. I can't speak for the rest of the world, but I can just speak for our country. Our country is built on comeback stories.
Yeah.
Our country is built on comebacks. We love a good comeback story. Every one of us, every child of God, is a comeback story in one sense or the other. Whether or not in the public arena or in a private arena, we're all a comeback story. Because if we don't quit believing, if our faith, if we never lose sight, and we never let go of that shield of faith, we never let go. It may falter out of our hands sometimes. If we're able to pick it back up and readjust and make sure and replant that our faith is ever anchored in what Jesus Christ has done, even though we've made that mistake, but our faith is still anchored in who He is and what He's done, God's going to pick us back up. And He's going to build us up once again. And I think we should be celebrating comeback stories and not celebrating defeats. But the church celebrates defeats, and we don't like comeback stories.
Why is it that we can be so self-righteous and so judgmental and so unaware of our own failure and our own sin? You know, the only thing that I can, the only conclusion that I can come up with is that, again, the heart, the deceitfulness of the heart, is we are deceived into thinking that that's not us, that we are better.
Wouldn't you say that it's a sheep? Wouldn't you say that it's a form of pride?
Well, sure, yeah.
Exactly. That's really what it boils down to, is we're so proud that that's not us. But we will never, ever allow someone to look into our hearts to see the skeleton of our closet. We get those but we will stop at nothing to tear people down whenever their skeletons get out of our closet.
Yeah, it goes back to the insignia, like Adam and Eve. We failed, we said, and we think we just cover up with the fig leaves and God can't see it.
And we know that others can't see it.
Right.
Yeah, that's what we, I think we're more concerned with other
right. Exactly, yeah.
Instead of what God says and God knows. And so, once again, as we come down to the close of today's program, I want you to understand something. Number one, if you yourself have been in one of those moments where you've allowed temptation to seep in, and you made a mistake, I want you to understand something. There is a way of escape. We're not judging you for that. We're not knocking you for that. All of us have made our fair share of mistakes. But here's the key. Don't quit. Keep your faith anchored in Christ, who He is and what He's done, because there's going to come a day when that thing is not going to bother you anymore. There may be that temptation, but you're not going to allow it to seep in and to take root and to land in the heart of your life. Keep your faith anchored. Keep a hold of that shield of faith. Don't let it take root. And to do so, keep your faith anchored in what Jesus Christ has done. Don't lose sight of the ultimate goal, which is Christ. Christ in us, the hope of the world. Keep your faith anchored in who He is and what He's done. I promise you, as we talked about it, it's going to come a time when you're going to realize, hey, this is easy. His burden is easy, or His yoke is easy, and His burden is light. We love you. God bless you. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for joining us for the Generation of the Cross, brought to you by Crossfire Youth Ministry at Family Worship Center in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Don't miss the Crossfire broadcast every Thursday night at 7 p.m. Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.
Mm-hmm.